Hello everyone. Today we are beginning a series of lectures on the topic radiographic techniques, safety and protection. There is a lot to be covered under this topic, so for the convenience of time and understanding, we have split this under various parts. And in this first part of the lecture, we'll be focusing on radiographic films and film-based radiography. So in your previous lecture, you would have been given an introduction regarding what is radiology and what do we generally do in terms of radiology in dentistry. So to give you a brief introduction, you can split radiology in the basis of acquisition of image into two parts. One is your conventional, which is film-based radiography, and the second one is digital radiography. So it's almost like using a camera with a film and a digital camera, more or less you can relate to it. Following this lecture, I'll be correlating a lot in terms of radiology with our use of our cameras and our gadgets, because there are a lot of similarities. So I hope the information will be useful as well. So to clarify, the conventional or the film-based radiography, in your third year, the context of our lectures are going to be surrounding intraoral radiography. So what is intraoral radiography? When the receptor is placed inside the mouth, that is intraoral, and image is procured, then it is related to as intraoral radiography. When the receptor is placed outside externally and an image is formed, processed and interpreted, then it falls under extraoral radiography. So here we are going to be talking about intraoral radiography mostly. So first and foremost, primarily we need to understand what is a radiograph film and what is a radiograph. So X-ray film generally means the carrier or the mode in which we are going to acquire the radiograph. It can either be film based or it can be digitally, that is it can be a sensor. Here the context is film. Do not confuse this with the radiograph. This is a radiograph, whereas the film which we are going to talk about further in detail now is the unexposed mode on which, or material on which, the image is going to be formed. So basically you can categorize films based on various parameters. One of the most common parameters will be based on the size of the film. So there are intraoral films which are placed within a patient's mouth, are available in various sizes for various which are utilized for various purposes. So we start with a size 0, which is generally used in small children. Then a size 1, which is most commonly used in anteriors, in imaging of anteriors, that is from canine to canine, upper and lower. And then we have size 2. Now remember this, the size 2 is the adult IOPA, which is the most common form of IOPA that we will be using in our practice. Apart from this, you have a relatively long but not very significantly used bite wing, which roughly measures about 27 into 54 millimeter, and they are particularly used for a certain type of radiograph. And then finally you have size 4, which is the largest among all. While all the above radiograph from size 0 to size 3 are focused on just imaging tooth, the size 4 is capable of also recording the bone or the anatomical structures adjacent to the tooth. It can either involve partial or the entire maxilla, or partial or the entire mandibular arch. So these you can categorize them based on size. Apart from this, you can also categorize them based on speed. based on speed, you have films that have speed A, speed B, speed C, speed D, speed E, and speed F. Among this, speed A, speed B, and speed C are not in usage anymore, or at least commercially, we do not use it anymore in our intraoral radiography. The most recommended by the various authorities are the speed D and speed E films. They are considered to be fast films, and speed D is just exclusive for occlusal radiographs. So based on the speed of the films, speed A, speed B, and speed C are considered to be slow films, and speed D is considered to be ultra speed, which we use in occlusal radiograph. Speed E is supposed to be ecta speed, which we use in our normal IOPAs. Apart from this, we also have a F speed film, which is almost the last and the latest which the speed of the films have evolved to, and they are ultra ecta speed. But this transition of development in the speed of the film has come to a halt almost because of the advent of digital radiography. Now we have seen what are the basic categories of films that are available. Now let's dive in and see what are these films and how are these films composed and how to use them. To start off with, first let's understand what does a film packet consists of. So you should understand that in intraoral radiology, it is not easy to carry a cassette. Some of you might have. It has become little uncommon, but some of you might have seen that radiographers go into a dark room, they bring out a cassette in which they load a film and they take X-rays. Now remember, early on days before, when people like Edmund Kells were taking radiographs, so we used to have an intraoral cassette, which means there used to be a solid cassette within which they used to place the film light protected and place it inside, that is intraorally to acquire. This posed various challenges. So what happened is the cassettes used to be very rigid, so placing them intraorally, that is within the patient's mouth, became very difficult. Patient had very unpleasant and so much discomfort in getting radiography done. So in evolution of radiography in intraoral film, what we use instead of a film, we use what we call IOPA, or the film consists of a film packet within which you have a black paper, which the role of the black paper is to filter light, and then you have a lead foil backing, and then you have within it you have the X-ray film itself. So if you see the image on your left hand side, you can very well see that there is an overall covering, which is the film packet, within which there is a layer of black paper. On one side of the packet alone, you have a lead foil backing, and then there is the X-ray film. Now let me explain the purpose of the arrangement of this, the contents within the film packet. So the external waterproof outer packet serves as a container, that is a light for light proofing, as well as contamination from saliva. So it is airtight, and so it prevents, and it's solid, so that there is no transition of light within, and it is also sealed well, that there is no contamination from saliva. The black paper serves to absorb the moisture, any moisture that is formed. There is a certain parameter in terms of storage of the film. If the films are not stored well, if they are stored in a very moist place, so what happens is there is water droplets which can form within the film packet, which might lead to lot of disruptions in image forming, or which might contaminate the film itself. So the black paper is present both as a light filter as well as to absorb moisture. Then on one side of the film packet, you have a lead foil backing. just remember that this lead foil backing is to protect that particular site from exposure and also backscattering of X-ray ions. We'll discuss that further as we go on into the lecture, in the further lectures. And there is our X-ray film in middle of all this. So what does an X-ray film consist of? So from the middle, if we go, it consists of a base, it consists of a base, and then over it, it consists of an adhesive. The adhesive holds the base and another layer called emulsion. Over the emulsion, to protect the emulsion, there is a super coat. Now let's see a little bit in detail what are the functionality of layers. The base is usually a single layer made of polyester, polyethylene, terephthalate, which you can in a simplified term called a plastic layer, which is uniformly translucent and it has a slight blue tint because to enhance the image, the contrast of the image, there is a slight blue tint that is given. It is very flexible and it has a very good dimensional stability and it is inert. So it is usually 0.8 millimeter thick, and over this a layer of adhesive, and above that we have something called as an emulsion. This emulsion is a very important part of the intraoral periapical radiograph film. So the role of the base itself is to support the emulsion. So what is this emulsion? So this emulsion usually consists of a silver halide grains, which also can constitute of sulfur and gold to increase the sensitivity. And it is carried. So all these crystals, this silver halide and silver bromide, gold and sulfur crystals, are carried using a vehicle that is like a, you know, like a layer called gelatin, which is gelatinous in nature. And this gelatinous base is usually made of cattle bone, sometimes it can also be, you know, non-gelatinous also. And over this there is a super coat, which is the protective coat to protect the emulsion. So here what we have to understand is that the emulsion is the most important part of the radiographic film. So the purpose of the base is to carry the emulsion intact, and the adhesive's role is to hold the emulsion and the base together. And super coat, the purpose of the super coat is to protect the emulsion. And the emulsion consists of materials like silver halide, silver bromide crystals. It also consists of small trace elements of gold, and also it consists of sulfur. So what is the role of this sulfur and gold? Okay, this sulfur and gold makes this film or the emulsion part of the film more sensitive to light than it already is. The important component of this emulsion part is the silver halide grains. Okay, now remember when we talked about speed of the films, speed A, speed B, speed C, speed D, speed E and speed F. I told you that A, B and C are slow speed and D, E, F are fast speed. Okay, so the silver halide grains or the structure of the silver halide grains is the one determines the speed of the film. Okay, we'll see that when there. So for example, in ultra speed, that is E speed films, what happens is that the diameter of the silver halide crystals or the grains increases. So generally the globular crystals are somewhere about 1 micrometer, and it requires little more exposure. The more smaller the silver halide grains are or the silver bromide grains are, it needs more exposure for the image to form. And for example in F speed film, the silver halide grains are larger in size, about 1.8 micrometer. So, and the structure of the silver halide and silver bromide crystals are oriented parallel to each other. So what happens is that the potential for the of the emulsion layer or the film to take X-rays and convert them into image, it becomes more, it is more efficient in the F-speed films compared to that of E-speed film. So in a descending order, F being the most sensitive, E being second to F, D being second next to E, and it goes on like that. So as I said to you before, now we only use D, E and F speed films. E speed films are the one which are most commonly used now for our IOPAs, bite wings, even in pediatric graphs, that is size 0 radiographs. And the occlusal films that we use are D speed films. When you take the film packet on the whole, that is your intraoral periapical radiograph or any intraoral radiograph, I already told you there is a film packet. On one side of the film is the exposure side and other side of the film is non-exposure side. Now remember the lead foil that I talked to you about, that lead foil will always be on the non-exposure side. And as you can see in the image, in most of the IOPAs, it will be clearly mentioned that the side of the lead foil will be mentioned as opposite side towards the tube or non-exposure side, whereas the exposure side, that is the side to be exposed, will always be flat and plain. Now when we are going to image singular tooth, or we are going to isolate a tooth or two and we are just going to take the radiograph for that particular side, to avoid confusion between the sides, that is the left and right, we all know that for example your lower molars, your lower first molar has two roots. It is the same for both right and left. So over a period of time, there is a chance that it might get you might get confused as to which side it belongs to. When you do not have the number mentioned on it, you might get confused. So to clarify that, we have something called as an identification dot. The one the arrow points to, it is actually, you will not see any color, but you will see a small elevation in the corner of the film. You might be able to feel it. That is on the exposure side, it will be convex, and on the non-exposure side, it will be concave. Using that, we'll be able to identify the sides. So when you come for a practical demonstration, when you come back to college, when there is going to be a practical demonstration, we'll discuss this, and when you actually fill it on the radiograph, it'll be more clear for you. So what are the steps in doing a radiographic examination? By talking about this, this generally suits for all film-based radiology. So for this, the first step is exposing the film to X-ray. So we position the patient, we position the radiograph, and then we expose the radiograph to X-ray. Then the second step will be processing, and the third step will be interpretation. So each of these steps has various processes within itself, which we will be discussing further. In this concept of taking the image and processing, there is in between, there is an area, or there is a concept called as latent image formation. So if you remember the previous slide, first I told exposing the radiograph or taking the radiograph. Once we take the radiograph, immediately if you look at the film, if you open the packet and look at the film, you will not be able to see the image. You have to subject it to processing for you to evidently see this image. So, but it doesn't mean that the image is not there in the radiograph. So the only when after we process, we are able to, it is visible to our it is visible to our naked eyes. But in the transitional phase after taking the radiograph, before processing it, the data or the information that is stored within the film is called an latent image. Let's see what is latent image in a little bit of detail. So we all know that a radiographic film is a recording medium used in dental radiography, and when this film is exposed to information carrying beam or the X-rays in an object, of the photosensitive silver halide crystals, I told you already, the emulsion consists of silver halide and silver bromide crystals, which are photosensitive, and to increase the sensitivity a little bit, they add trace elements of gold and sulfur. So the photosensitive silver alloy crystals in the film emulsion interact with these the photons in the X-rays, and they are chemically altered. That is, the structure of them are altered, and these chemically altered crystals are said to constitute the latent image or the invisible image in the film. Remember what I told you. As soon as you expose the patient to X-rays, the film to X-ray, and you go open the packet and see, you will not be able to see the image. But that doesn't mean the film does not carry the information. Only thing is, you have to subject it to processing. And this transitional phase, in which it is not, the image is not visible to our eyes, but the image is still carried, is called a latent image formation. These chemical changes in the crystals increase the liability of the crystals to chemical action of developing process that converts the latent image into visible image. So the formation of the latent image, the film emulsion, is made of silver bromide crystals and silver iodide crystals, like I told you, that is precipitated in gelatin or non-gelatinous base layered on the thin sheet of transparent base. And these silver iodide crystals are chemically sensitized by the presence of sulfur compounds, which can cause physical irregularities in the crystals produced by iodide ions. And these are called latent image sites. The function of the latent image site is to begin the process of image formation by trapping the electrons generated when the emulsion is irradiated. When the silver iodide crystals are irradiated, the electron released changes bromide ion into bromine atom. So this will produce kinetic energy with which it moves the crystal and strikes the image site, imparting a negative change in that region. So then free positively charged interstitial silver ions are attached to the negative latent image site, and the image site, with the result that an atom or metallic silver is deposited at that site. After exposure of a film to radiation, the aggregate silver atoms at the latent image site comprises of a latent image. It is the metallic silver at each latent image site that catalyzes the development of halide crystal, in which it is formed, and it forms and renders the crystal sensitive crystal, make it very sensitive to development and image formation. So remember this, latent image formation is very significant. Unless or until a latent image formation process occurs, we are not going to get an end result after developing. So this is a process that happens. A latent image formation is a process that happens within the film once it is exposed to radiation. Okay, now we have seen what is a film, and what are the contents of a film packet, and what are the layers of the film, and what components of the film enable image formation within the film itself. Now, in intraoral periapical radiograph, okay, there are three different types of intraoral radiography techniques that are commonly used. Or three modalities that are commonly used. First one being intraoral periapical radiograph, which we generally refer to as IOPA or IOPAR. So what are these IOPAR, we'll discuss as we go on further. The second one being the bite-wing radiographs, and third one being the occlusal radiographs. So remember, now from the size of the film, we usually use size 2 films for taking an intraoral periapical radiograph. So to take an intraoral periapical radiograph, there are two techniques that are followed to take an intraoral periapical radiograph. One being a bisecting angle technique, and another one being your parallelic technique. So we'll discuss these techniques as in the classes as we go on, but just learn the names, or just get a brief idea that there are two techniques that we use. Now as we discussed before, first there is taking of the radiograph. So for taking of the radiographs, what are the components or what are the things that you need? First, what you need is a film. Second, what you need is an intraoral radiograph machine, and of course the patient. So the film, the receptor. So here we are more talking about the film, that is the receptor, okay? And using this receptor and using this source of x-ray with the patient, how we are going to take a radiograph. That technique is what we are talking about, the bisecting angle and the parallel technique. So for bisecting angle, for achieving bisecting angle technique, we use a holder, film holder, which is called snap array. And for paralleling technique, we have something called as an XCP guide ring. So here in bisecting angle technique, what happens is that the film is positioned using a film holder inside the patient's mouth, and there is a certain angulation, predetermined angulation, patient head position, and with which we try to achieve, and we try to aim and shoot at an imaginary bisecting line by the triangle formed by the long axis of the tooth and the film. This is a bisecting angle technique, whereas in paralleling technique, the receptor, that is the film, the subject, that is the tooth, the long axis of the tooth, is both are parallel to each other, and the x-ray is x-ray, the line of the x-ray is perpendicular to both of them. It might be a little overwhelming or a little confusing while I tell it now. We will discuss this in detail with more representations, pictographic and animatory representations, where we discuss the techniques of radiographs. So what next? What are the things that we are going to see as further? Now here, now we have only talked about the receptor, that is the radiographic films. Next, we'll be discussing the radiographic techniques, which I gave you a brief introduction about in this lecture, the intraoral periapical radiograph and using bisecting angle technique and your paralleling technique. And we'll talk about projection geometry, which is a part of the bisecting angle technique. And then we'll be talking about processing the radiographs. So like I told you, remember, there are three steps. First, taking the radiographs. Second is processing the radiographs. We'll also be talking about processing the radiographs. Then interpreting the radiographs will follow after this. Whatever we have discussed today can be a little overwhelming because it's a lot of information. And remember this, these are things that have been in practice and use for quite some time now, for decades now. It is not a new concept and it has been there. Although today mostly we are transitioning towards digital radiography, a lot of places still favor film based radiography, primarily due to the reason, which is cost. This is what I am telling now is little irrelevant or not directly associated with our lecture today, but this is for our understanding. While we have already moved on, nobody uses film cameras anymore. They have become museum objects, especially after the advent of getting camera in your mobile phones and you're having digital camera. Now we have moved to mirrorless cameras. Nobody uses film based cameras anymore. They were a thing in the 90s. Nobody uses it anymore. But why are we still using film based radiography in dentistry even today? Well, let me explain. That is the primary reason being cost of the armamentarium. The intraoral radiography machine alone will cost you a few thousand ringgits, and apart from that, if you are going to use digital radiography, the receptors, that is instead of a film, you will be using a digital sensor. The sensors are even more expensive. And understand this, that setting up a radiographic examination room or an x-ray setup within your clinic is not a very simple process. There is a lot to it. So it becomes very complex and it becomes overburdening in terms of cost and investment for a dentist. That is why even today you can notice that a few of the primary dental care clinics do not even have a radiographic facility within their clinic, or they might still be practicing a film based, because here the cost of the digital sensor has been cut off by the use of film and the processing chemicals. Well, this is not cheap either, but comparatively a little cheaper. And we will be discussing further. And although the government is encouraging dentists to, you know, move towards digital and scrape film based imaging, we must understand it is not going to happen overnight. This transition of completely becoming digital, the country becoming completely digital in terms of radiograph, will take some time, because it needs both human and financial potential. So it will take some time, and this film based radiography is there to stay at least for a few more years. So possibly even the time when you guys get into practice. So it is important for us to understand this film based imaging for us to effectively practice them. So as I mentioned before, further on we'll be discussing more about this. For further reading, I recommend you to study from standardized textbooks. Please do not rely on notes, notes from your seniors or notes from anywhere for that matter. Try to directly study from standardized textbooks. And here I would recommend you to study from White and Ferro, textbook of oral radiology, or you can also study from Eric White's textbook of oral radiology. Please use standardized books and please read from textbooks. If there is any doubt, please get back to us. You can get back to me via the messenger service that is available in ePortal, or you can also get back to me via phone and email. The details of all of that is available in the ePortal. So see you soon in the next part of this lecture. Thank you.